Hi students, I'm Dr. Bhavna. In this lecture, we are going to continue with the topic that is called as ecology. So already we have started and we are entering into the fourth subtopic that is called as environmental issues. So in environmental issues, basically we should start with first, what are the agents which cause, agents which harm the environment. First is the major problem now associated is pollution. So what is the exact definition of pollution is any undesirable changes that takes place. It may be either chemical, biological, or you can say it may take place in air or water is called as pollution. And agents causing this are called as pollutants. So basically due to all these pollutants, we all are suffering from many diseases. So basically when we start here, first, we should protect our environment. For that, basically, there are four types. That is Water Act, Environmental Act, Solid Waste, how to manage this, how to treat the waste, how to sewage treatment, how is it taking place. That all we will see in this environmental issues. So basically, first, I want you to write the definition of the pollution. So pollution is undesirable changes that are chemical, biological, in air, water, soil is called as pollution. Any undesirable changes that are taking place like chemical or biological in the air or water or soil is called as pollution. The agents which are causing them are called as pollutants. Another important point that you should remember here is basically there are numerous acts which are given to conserve the environment. In the last class we have discussed about the biodiversity and its conservation. So in the biodiversity and its conservation, what is happening is the first, how to conserve the biodiversity, in situ protection, ex situ protection. Ex situ protection means numerous examples like botanical gardens, zoological parks, that is off-site protection I have given. Then next, in situ protection means it is on-site. Suppose if you are trying to conserve a tiger, then along with the tiger, if full forest is preserved, then it is called under in situ protection. Under ex situ protection, if only the tiger is preserved, then it is called as ex situ protection. Then numerous examples are given. In ex situ protection, it is zoological parks, botanical gardens, and cryopreservation techniques. Cryopreservation techniques means numerous gametes and all. So, and in situ protection, there are again four types. Sacred groves, Aravali Hills of Rajasthan, Meghalaya deserts and all. Then numerous things we have seen in in situ protection. Like the first thing we have seen about the numerous, how are they preserved? Like wildlife sanctuaries, biosphere reserves and all. So that is about that. Then now we have seen about the pollutants acting and all. Now we have completed with that topic of biodiversity and conservation. Environment conservation is also necessary. Before chapter is about species conservation. Now the topic is about environment conservation. So how to dispose the waste and all, how numerous sewage treatments are taking place. So that is about that. So next term, there were numerous acts which are given. First is Environmental Act. So under Environmental Act, this act says that it should preserve the environment. So under which year it was taking places? It came into existence 1986. From this chapter, I want you all to remember the years. Here years are very important. Air Act when it was given, Water Act when it was given, Environment Act. Numerous times in NEET it was asked. 2-3 questions at least minimum they'll ask like this. So Environmental Act was given in the year 1986. Next, we will start with the first the water management. How should we conserve water? How is water preserved, and how is the lakes and all getting accumulated with the wastewater management? So now first we will start with water management. So first in the water management, you see numerous rivers, lakes and ponds. Are they very clean in nature? No. Everything is accumulated with so much amount of waste. So where are these coming from? First one is domestic sewage. Domestic sewage means whatever we are using in the home, all the dirty water which we are using, or the waste water, everything is going. You'll see in your houses numerous drainage pumps and all will be there. All the water is going there. From there, where it is going, it is all accumulated into numerous rivers and all. So all the waste water is flowing into the rivers, streams, lakes, ponds and all. So all are these getting accumulated. First, the domestic sewage, we said. Domestic means all household waste. Then the second one is industrial effluence. Industrial effluence means all the industrial waste, like nitrogen, phosphorus, carbon, numerous elements will be there. They are also from industries, they are getting down into the streams. Then from other different sources also, all is coming and getting accumulated into the lakes and ponds. So to preserve the lakes and ponds in this nature, because all if it is get, all the sea and all if it get filled with waste, is there drinking water available for us? No, the drinking water will not be available for you all to drink for future purposes. So we should perfectly treat the sewage, means all the dirty waste water should be waste in the water, should be separated, and only the pure water should go into the rivers. That is a small process which should be taking place. All the in the government should come forward to make this treatment happens. And we should not waste water also. Whatever the water which is coming from all, everything is coming from lakes and ponds or seas only. So that water also we should not waste. Now if you go in Hyderabad to Hussainsagar at least, or you go in Mumbai to some lakes and ponds, everything they are filled with all the waste only. Everything from household and all. We are not cleaning also. They are getting accumulated, they are forming the bacteria, and in turn that water only is again consumed by us. This is all a complicated process. So that's why an act was proposed called as Water Act. To conserve the water, Water Act was given in the year 1974. This was the first year where the act was given. Before I have told you 1986, that is Environmental Act. This is Water Act. I want you to not get confused regarding this, because Water Act, it was the first act which was given, and it was proposed in 1974. 1986, it was Environmental Act which was given. So the water management takes place like this. Then first and foremost, I told you the water is getting accumulated with numerous impurities. So in the domestic sewage and industrial effluents, first initially it is getting accumulated with all the impurities. So how much are impurities getting contributed in the whole water? So in the total 100%, about 99% is pure water. 99.9% is pure water, only 0.1% is impurities. In the 0.1% impurities only, this is making the unfit for human resources. It is making for unfit, only 0.1%, though impurities are present. So that's why we should properly manage water. If these 0.1% impurities are removed, pure water will be there for us. And in this 0.1% impurities, there are again three types which are associated, that are called as suspended solids. Second is colloidal materials. The third is dissolved substances. So suspended solids, colloidal materials and dissolved substances. In the suspended solids, the first one is like sand and clay. Examples: sand, clay. Colloidal materials are bacteria, paper, cloth and all. Dissolved substances are nitrates, phosphates and all. So these are the three main impurities which are present. The first one is like suspended solids, then colloidal substances, dissolved substances. Under suspended solids, it is like sand and clay. All the sand and the clay which is present, those are all will come under suspended because they are suspended deep into the water. Then colloidal, all the waste materials like bacteria, paper, cloth materials, and all are colloidal substances. Next, dissolved substances is nitrates, phosphorus, all the chemicals, all the nutrients which are present are coming under the dissolved substances. So these 0.1% impurities which are present, they make the water unfit for human resources. So this is about mainly what is present in the domestic sewage as well as the industrial effluents. I want you all to remember basically the Water Act, which was proposed in what was the act when it was proposed is in 1974, Environmental Act 1986. Now impurities what are present is suspended, dissolved and colloidal materials and numerous examples. In NEET they will ask, they will give you one example and they will ask nitrates, phosphate and all will come under which substance, like dissolved or it is dissolved. Again they will give you sand, clay and all. So they will come under the suspended solids. Colloidal is bacteria, cloth, papers, all the waste materials will be coming under this. Now in the domestic sewage mainly contains the biodegradable organic matter. Domestic sewage contains biodegradable organic matter. So what is this biodegradable organic matter? It is, see, the all the nutrients rich which are present like nitrogen, phosphorus, this all contribute to biodegradable organic matter. They are naturally present in this domestic sewage. So what will happen regarding this? These allow the growth of microorganisms. Numerous microorganisms will grow along with this biodegradable organic matter, and all the waste, all the sewage, they'll degrade into small particles. Like they will decompose into the smaller particles, all the biodegradable organic matter. The microorganisms which are inbuilt present in this biodegradable organic matter means only there are numerous microorganisms which are present, and these all microorganisms, they degrade into smaller, they decompose the organic matter. When they decompose the organic matter, numerous microorganisms which are present, they take so much amount of oxygen. They take this so much amount of oxygen and they will not allow other organisms to grow. Suppose if you take the case of a river or a pond, numerous plants, numerous animals, numerous species will be there. They all require, numerous fishes will be there. They all require oxygen for them. But when this biodegradable organic matter is present and numerous microorganisms are associated with it, they only consume so much amount of oxygen and it will not be available for the other fishes and plants to take so much amount of oxygen. So what will happen? There will be oxygen deficiency which will be happening in the lakes or rivers. So that is called as biochemical oxygen demand. So there is a demand for that of oxygen, and it is called as biochemical oxygen demand. BOD. So the amount of biodegradable organic matter is usually measured in terms of substrate by biochemical oxygen demand which is present in that of water. So I want you all to clearly remember regarding this. Numerous NEET questions will be asked based on biochemical oxygen demand only. So that the organisms are not acquiring sufficient amount of oxygen for breathing, and the main indigenous flora and fauna which are present in the lakes, they all are dead due to this biodegradable organic matter which is present in domestic sewage. That's why the domestic sewage should not be entering into the rivers or lakes or ponds. If this is entering, so many indigenous flora and fauna will die due to this. So I want you to clearly remember this is one topic regarding the domestic sewage. When you go into the second topic of domestic sewage, there will be numerous amount of growth of organic matter as well as planktonic growth of algae which are present, and this fully will be growing on the rivers. The algae which is present, planktonic algae, you see. When this algae will be growing on the rivers, on the topmost, we can say it as this planktonic algae as, you can say it as algal bloom. Algal bloom. They impart a different color to the water bodies. Once if it start, it will spread throughout the river. So, and it will not allow the indigenous flora and fauna to grow. So this is the second topic that is associated with the domestic sewage. The first one is biodegradable organic matter, which is associated with biochemical oxygen demand. The second one is algae, the planktonic algae, presence of the algae, which will grow on the rivers. When it will grow on the rivers, it will, it called as algal bloom. It imparts different color to the water bodies, as well as when this grows, proper nutrients will not be available or proper sunlight will not be available to the fishes which are present in the water. So this is also a dangerous mechanism which was associated with domestic sewage. Next, the third important point that you should remember is regarding the most problematic aquatic weed. Which is growing on the surface of water is Eichhornia. Caspians. Eichhornia caspians. So this is the famous aquatic weed. When it was introduced into one lake, it rapidly spread throughout the lake, and it to remove it also it was not possible. And inside water will be there, this will fully cover the lake. So that water will not be available for us for consumption, as well as this will fully occupy the river. So this is the most problematic aquatic weed which is present. And then this is, the name is Eichhornia, aquatic weed, Eichhornia caspians. And this is also famously called as Terror of Bengal. Terror of Bengal. because in Bengal lakes, it rapidly spread and it created a havoc to numerous other ecosystem was disturbed due to this plant basically. So this is the famous plant which is called as Terror of Bengal. They'll ask you in NEET which is called as Terror of Bengal. And they'll give you numerous options, Icornia. Then another numerous different plants they'll give. It is called as Icornia caspiens. It is called as Terror of Bengal. So this is about that. And then another important thing that you should remember is the second most presence of planktonic algae I told you. How this planktonic algae, algal bloom was developed is due to the nutrients which are present. The numerous nutrients get accumulated on the river. If the lake is very nutrient rich, nutrients means all the phosphorus, carbon and all. If it is nutrient rich, then it leads to growth of numerous like algae. So that the algae can survive, but it will disturb the original plants and animals which are associated with it. So these are the three main concepts which are associated with domestic sewage. There is another important topic. Suppose from households, numerous domestic sewage was released from numerous households. So when numerous domestic sewage was released, it leads to numerous waterborne diseases. What are the waterborne diseases which you see? They are typhoid. They'll ask you what are the waterborne diseases. Are typhoid, cholera, dysentery. These are the main waterborne diseases which are associated. Typhoid, cholera, dysentery, amebiasis and are also waterborne through food and water it may spread. But exclusively waterborne diseases are typhoid, cholera, dysentery and all are waterborne diseases which will come into play. So when domestic sewage was introduced into the water, if the water is stagnant for a long time, it leads to numerous waterborne diseases. That is about the typhoid, cholera as well as dysentery. Another important thing is, and from numerous industries also, so much amount of water is released from numerous industries. So this water contains the density of greater than 5 grams. This is about households which I have told from houses. Now I am talking about numerous industries. In industries greater than 5 density, 5 gram per liter density of numerous harmful compounds like chlorine, phosphorus are released into the water. Numerous harmful compounds. So when they are released into the water through these industries, it again led to the development of numerous diseases. So from households as well as from the industries, numerous harmful compounds were released. So this is about the mainly sewage that is related to houses as well as industries. Till now, four concepts I have dealt with. The first four important concepts are, first concept, Water Act. When it was given? It was given in 1974. What is the definition of pollution? What are pollutants? When was Environmental Act given? 1986, Water Act 1974. Then I have described starting it with the numerous domestic sewage and industrial effluents. Maximum it is with water, that is 99% is water, only 0.1% is impurities. Dissolved example is sand, nitrates, phosphates, suspended is sand and clay. The third colloidal is the numerous bacteria, cloth and papers and all. Then again when you have started with the concept of biodegradable oxygen demand, so many plants and animals are suffering from biochemical oxygen demand because in the domestic sewage, biodegradable organic matter is present. In those, so many microorganisms are present. These microorganisms only consume lot and lots of oxygen. So, perfect oxygen is not available for these, for the other animals to or plants to take in. So, they suffer from biochemical oxygen demand. So, that is about that. That was done. Then, from domestic sewage, it leads to numerous waterborne diseases like typhoid, cholera, dysentery and all. Then from industries, important need question, greater than 5 gram per density is present because of presence of numerous chemicals which was released from industries like nitrates, phosphates, sulfur and all, numerous chemicals which are present. Then we have talked about the most invasive weed that is called as Eichornia caspians, it is also called as terror of Bengal. It's widely spread throughout the lake and it will cause numerous disturbances. Then the fourth important point that you should remember is basically related to that of the second important point of first is like biochemical oxygen demand. This is for the industries from the home. Then the algal bloom. This algal bloom leads to so much amount of accumulation of when humus is accumulated, how in the earth, like that algal bloom also is getting accumulated in numerous lakes. It leads to color change in numerous water bodies. You will see some water bodies full of domestic sewage and it leads to pungent smell also. So this is about the algal bloom. Then next we are talking about a major topic that is called as eutrophication of lakes. What is eutrophication of lakes? In the eutrophication is natural aging of the lake. Is natural aging of the lake. The like because of accumulation of so much amount of numerous harmful substances. First, in a fresh lake, if you see, the water will be very cold. The water will be very pure in its nature. But the natural aging of the lake will take place, means how it is taking place, not by because of thousands or millions of years, not like that. It is taking place due to accumulation of all these waste from industries, from numerous households. When all this water is getting accumulated there, full it is occupying on the water surface. When it is occupying on the water surface, what is happening? It is getting eutrophication is done, natural aging of the lake is done. So the water before, when it was very cold and pure, now they will become very warm. The water will become very warm and numerous nutrients, numerous phosphorus and all are getting accumulated on the water. Fully they are getting accumulated on the water. When all are getting accumulated on the water, what is happening? It leads to natural eutrophication. Due to that, so many organisms are not able to survive also. As well as there is another concept called as accelerated eutrophication. Now we humans are contributing to this of accelerated eutrophication. Than that of normal, we are improving more of aging of lakes by dumping so much amount of waste into these lakes and ponds. So much amount of waste are getting accumulated on the water surface, so much amount are getting accumulated, like industrial effluents and all. So this is about the eutrophication as well as accelerated eutrophication of the lakes. Then there is another topic that is called as biomagnification. With the topic of biomagnification as well as there is a case study of integrated wastewater management. So how it was done? That all we will see in the next class. For today, we have started with a new topic, environmental issues. We have started with how to conserve the water, what is Water Act, when it was given, how are rivers and lakes and ponds, how they are getting accumulated with sewage, how is domestic sewage and industrial effluents contributing to that of wastewater. And now we will see in the future about how is wastewater management and all taking place, and then about the Air Act, solid waste and all in the next class, okay?